Good evening. It's time for another chapter of Iraklian Magazine. I'm Kathy Urban. Steve Hall and I have some interesting stories about the community tonight.
In this edition, we'll be going to Torrejon Air Base, Spain, to take a look at some folks serving an unaccompanied tour there, which wouldn't be too unusual, except they're high school students, and their parents are stationed here.
We'll also explore the base library, a quiet place only at first glance.
We'll take a glance at March happenings on Touch and Go, travel to a pita stand in the Great Island segment,
and meet another interesting person on Spotlight with Deborah Hall. Iraklian Magazine for April is coming right up, the show all about you. Don't go away.
Halloween Eve, 1938. Millions listen to radio reports detailing a Martian invasion at Grover's Mills, New Jersey. The vivid descriptions created blind panic. Next day, Orson Welles apologized to the world for the impact of his radio dramatization of War of the Worlds. The acceptance of that play as real is still used to demonstrate how easily a mass audience can be influenced.
You know, it's a fact of life that most military members have run across at least once in their careers, and that's family separations are no fun. My wife and I got a small taste of that last month when I was sent to Torrejon Air Base, Spain for some training. Now, while I was there, I encountered a group of other unaccompanied folks serving at Torrejon. And you know, it's hard enough for us grown-ups to take the separation, but these folks were high school students, and their parents are stationed right here. 3:20 p.m. It could be any day. And at Torrejon High in Spain, school's out. And just like any high school scene, students are streaming from class, catching up on the latest good gossip, and of course, thinking about getting home. Most of Torrejon High students will board buses today and settle in for the long ride to the Royal Oaks housing area, about 15 miles off base. But a handful will find their way to this building. The sign may call it a residence hall, but the kids who live here call themselves the dormies. They range in age from 15 to 18, and their parents are stationed a lot farther away than base housing. Countries like Somalia, Madagascar, Saudi Arabia, and Yemen. Bases too small to accommodate high school students in their junior and senior years. Bases like Iraklian Air Station. Seven children whose parents are based at Iraklian live in Torrejon's student dorm. I was able to talk with three. Mike Flynn is a junior at Torrejon High who spent his last 8 months getting used to dorm living.
What's it like actually living in the dorm away from your folks?
I don't really have any problems here. I thought I would at the beginning of the year, but no, it's been pretty easy. No, you miss your parents and you miss mom's cooking and everything, and we have to eat at the chow hall, and it's usually not the greatest thing in the world, but you get used to it. After, you know, you get sponsors, which are people that sign you out to go live with them on the weekend or something. They take care of you and you have fun.
We spoke to Mike's parents, James and Mine Flynn, at their home in downtown Iraklion. They recall the initial separation.
I didn't like it. No, I really did miss him. But no, I've gotten used to it.
I noticed a big change in Mike when he came back Christmas time. I think it does a lot for the kids. It puts them out on their own, and a lot of them want that.
Sandra Duvall could probably write a book on family separations. She has two kids at Torrejon, and when we talked to her, her husband Cliff was TDY at the NCO Academy. Her daughter Jenna is in her second year at Torrejon.
The first year was unbelievable. Jennifer, it was very hard for Jen to leave home, never having left home before, and going that far away, and us not at even home. I appreciated the, if it hadn't been for a telephone, we could never have made this.
I talked to Jenna in her dorm room at Torrejon, and she knew exactly what Mom was talking about.
Well, last year it was really hard on my mom.
Yeah.
When I first, you know, she'd call me all the time, oh, I miss you, you know, and I used to get really, really homesick. And like on my birthday, you know, my first birthday by myself, you know, and she called, we kept getting cut off, and I was like, oh, this is so awful, I can't believe this, you know.
We've always had a tradition in our family that on their birthdays, we call as early as we can in the morning and sing happy birthday. And this has been going, my oldest daughter's 30 years old. This has been going on all these years. And on Jennifer's birthday, I had called her like 3 days before her birthday and said, happy birthday to you, 3 days before your birthday. And then we did 2 days before your birthday. And the day of the birthday, I couldn't get through. And I tried and I tried and I tried and I couldn't get through. At about 10 minutes to 8, this very sad, crying child called me and said, Mommy, you didn't sing happy birthday. And I said, oh, Jennifer, I've been trying for an hour, and I couldn't get to you. So I sang happy birthday, and we both cried, and it was okay, but it was an awful experience.
Frank and Helen Holmes' daughter, Vanessa, is a junior at Torrejon. They found that homesickness works both ways.
That's the hardest thing to deal with the homesickness. And even though we were prepared with by Dr. Howitt's conferences he had, and other parents who'd gone through the same thing, it's you still can't be prepared for when that phone rings and you've got an unhappy child at the other end.
Their daughter Vanessa says it's no picnic starting out, but everyone pulls together.
It was about a month after I first got here. That's when I got the initial shock. It was like, oh, I'm away from home. But as it comes together, everybody has the same feelings, and it happens about the same time, so everybody just can talk to everybody else. And one thing that's really important about it here is the dorm is one big family. If somebody has a problem, it's everybody's problem.
Family was a term I heard used often to describe the atmosphere in the dorm.
You know, you really don't get in fights here, argue with anyone here, you know. Everyone just knows everyone, they get along.
As soon as everybody got used to new people and a new environment, we were so close. It was just like family.
People help each other.
Yeah, and that's what's really great, because that helps everybody make it through the times, is when everybody's helping everybody else.
Kids helping each other and looking out for each other helps Araklion's dormies keep it together a long way from home. Our next story has a little to do with school as well, in that it's a great place to study. But it's also a great place for a lot of other interesting things. Kathy has some surprising finds from the library.
Walk into a library, and chances are the first thing you'll notice before the rows of books, even before the other people milling around, is the silence. While a library itself may have nothing to say, there's a lot to be said for a library. Across the United States and at military installations worldwide, libraries and the people who run them will have their say during National Library Week, April 8th through 14th. It's a time everyone is invited to drop in, ask questions, or just look around. Just look around the nearest stack of books, and you'll find the man spearheading the seven-day jamboree, William Price, the base librarian. On Crete for 7 months, he spent 20 years surrounded by books and binders, and has a master's degree in library science. We talked about the purpose for a National Library Week.
National Library Week is a time where all libraries open their libraries and expound on their services, offering special programs, inviting the public to come in to really see what libraries are all about. Most people tend to think libraries are a collection of books, but we're more than a collection of books.
Much more. Libraries hold a fascinating conglomeration within their four walls. Whatever you want, whatever your whim, from business to banter, the Northeast and Midwest, from learning to listening to lounging. libraries are for you. There is no age limit here, no time limit between when the doors open for business and when they close. Most of all, there is no limit to what can be learned by taking the time to explore.
We've got books on reserve for our class, so we have to come here and study.
If you want to get started on learning about Cree, this is the best place.
I usually come to bone up on the background material for the course.
Knowledge is real power. That's the theme for National Library Week. I asked Mr. Price for his interpretation. Simply put, he said, without knowledge, without learning, we cannot achieve. It makes sense. One book can bring that which is a little closer.
And therefore,
and that which is no longer, a library can recapture.
Ich bin ein Bierling.
There's a light side to the text. Libraries aren't just for research. They're not just overstuffed history bins. Meet the Yellow Pages. They're not condensed, just compressed. Iraklian's library has an up-to-date telephone directory on microfiche. It includes resident and business numbers in every major U.S. city. Also on microfiche, information on U.S. and major overseas colleges and universities, alphabetically filed and easy to use. But then, anything is easy to use once you know how. What about when you don't?
The main purpose is to help. So if a person walks through the door and is intimidated by the technology and the library in itself, all they have to do is come over and say, I need help. Or if we sense that the person is at a loss, we will immediately offer assistance to anyone who comes to the library.
Bearing that in mind, you'll want to take advantage of the house sound system, a combination turntable and cassette, complete with headphones. The music, they've got that too. This storehouse of information is run by a staff of nine, including volunteers. People like Donna Crabtree, who give a few hours each week to help keep the library running smoothly. Everyone benefits from the volunteers' assistance, even the children.
You'd help me guess. Rap, tap, howdy do. Who am I? I sit on a log. I live in a bog. Bog, bog, bog. Who am I? It rhymes with bog.
Friday afternoons at 1:30, it's story time for preschool through second graders. There are two groups divided by age. One of the readers, Joyce Rapp, says choosing the books is an important step in the program.
We try to choose books that the children can participate in, ones where we ask them a lot of questions, because at their age, the attention span is rather short, and if they can be participating, then they enjoy it a lot more.
The system that's worked very well at the library is the swap cart, a chance for paperback owners to bring in books they finished and swap them for others. There are also rows of paperbacks that can be checked out. Other customer services include a pattern swap for Butterick and Simplicity owners. A file drawer inconspicuously placed along the wall houses a wealth of arts and crafts information. Freebies are a way of life at the library. Start browsing through a magazine at most bookstores, and you'll probably get an askance look from the owner, something like, buy it or beat it. But you won't get that at the library. Newspapers from your part of the country. Periodicals, an entire wall to select from. Brochures, reference guides, maps, and music. They're there at your bidding, at your convenience. Make the library work. Stella Zakharaki is its backbone. Bill Price thinks of her as the continuity technician. After 9 years, Stella knows the job, and she likes it, as does library aide Stephanie Martin. It's a give-and-take kind of operation. Give a book, take another. Give 15 cents, and make yourself a copy. Give a little free time, and take advantage of everything the library has to offer.
It's amazing the amount of information you find out by helping someone else try to find an answer to some question.
Remember, you have a lot to offer, too.
Videos from Devo, Fun Boy 3, Human League, and Split Ends.
MV3, Rock and Roll Television for Heraklion, premieres this Thursday evening at 10:18.
We're not covering a particular town or village on tonight's Great Island segment, but we are covering something found in most of them.
Depressed with the same old hamburger and hot dog routine. Your pickle dies, your buns is hard, and your hot dog's lost its bite. Well, get out. Get out and enjoy Crate's cure for the fast food blues, the pita. The pita is scrumptious layers of pork, constantly cooking on a rotisserie. The name pita comes from the unleavened, or pita bread, used in this delicacy. While the bread, dipped in oil, is simmering on the grill, tender bits of pork are trimmed from the 20 to 25 pound spit of roasting meat. When the piping hot bread is removed from the grill, a spread or two of fresh yogurt is added. Next comes the tender pork morsels, a sprinkle of onions, and topped with a tomato. Wrapped in a shape similar to a hot dog bun, it's time to eat this inexpensive treat. Now, let's see. How do you eat the pita? Well, some people use the push approach. Others, the peel. And still others unwrap the entire pita. This last style seems to be the messiest. But regardless, the pita tastes great using any style.
Admiration for a person can stem from any number of reasons. Say they have a way with words, or a way with people, or a knack for doing something that just baffles a lot of us. That's the kind of person you'll meet tonight on Spotlight.
Now, if Kathy has made him sound just short of angelic, don't worry. You gotta know that Mark Hutchinson is just a little bit touched in the head, like the rest of us, which makes him more than bearable.
Deborah Hall has his story.
You are familiar with the broadcasters at AFRTS because you see or hear us every day. But the men who keep the station on the air, the AFRTS engineers, are rarely seen on screen. Our engineers are some of the best in the field. And we have one, Marcus Hutchinson, who's quite unique. In a Greek-American station, he's a foreigner. For a 40-hour work week, he earns nothing. And he prepared for this dubious privilege with 12 hours of study every day for 5 years at an English university. What sort of degree does he have?
Bachelor of Science degree for electrical and theory, electronic engineering.
That's quite complicated, isn't it?
It is. It's even to say.
Our engineers, in fact, don't have degrees, as far as I know.
Well, that's true. One of the engineers actually was, before he got here, was a bomb loader on a B-51.
Nonetheless, our engineers are quite skillful. An average day around the station includes cleaning and monitoring equipment, watching video levels, registering and operating the cameras for the daily newscasts, and general troubleshooting whenever a broadcaster screams in anguish when a machine falters or eats tape. Marcus also helped install AFTV's new video switcher, installing the video processor and borderline generator, what he calls the box where all the magic happens. He worked from 6 one morning until just before 1 that afternoon. We signed on for the day's broadcast 3 minutes later.
Is this enough of a challenge for you here?
Yeah, it is, because there's such a turnover of equipment, being the state-of-the-art equipment. See, there's such a good turnover of that. And it also helps. Okay, if I went in there and they said to me, well, Mr. Hutchinson, then what have you been doing for the last 2 years? And I said, well, sitting on a beach in the middle of the Mediterranean. I think they'll politely show me the door as staying here for 2 years, you see.
Do you feel working. That you're appreciated here?
Yes, I do. I really do. I do get a lot of pats on the back, but you have to work for them.
Marcus is what the Air Force calls a dependent. His active mind and boundless energy needed an outlet. So when he brought his knowledge of broadcast systems to the station and asked for a job, no payment required, the answer was quick and affirmative. Marcus says he's been doing this sort of thing since he was 10, assembling amateur radio kits and taking apart his remote control toys. As an adult, he's worked for the Sound and Light Corporation of London, going out on the road with Rod Stewart, Pink Floyd, Earth, Wind & Fire, The Rolling Stones, and Hot Chocolate. If you ever visit London, you might drop in at Stringfellow's nightclub. They feature an incredible computerized light show designed by our own Englishman. Needless to say, Marcus is quite a catch for AFTV and for all of Heraklion, as you'll see in our next segment, Touch and Go.
Thanks, Deborah. Mark Hutchinson also had a behind-the-scenes role in our first recap of the Touch and Go segment tonight.
Right. Teamed with another AFRTS engineer, John Garnish, Mark helped set up the sound system for a USO show well-remembered, the Dallas Cowboy Cheerleaders. On the squad, 8 on this particular USO tour. From Crete, they headed to Suda Bay and Athens, then to ships off the coast of Lebanon, 3 bases in Italy, and finally home. The show was entertaining and well choreographed. Even Redskin fans had to admit there are some good things about Dallas other than JR. The guys in the front row too much, you should know there was somebody who was one up on the entire crowd. Captain Dwight Daniels, Heraklion's public affairs officer, was just doing his job.
From
From the people whose job is at the post office, we had some good news this month. No charge for inter-theater correspondence. Staff Sergeant John Galvis gave us the details.
Effective the 2nd of April, the Military Postal Service will begin its new intra-theater delivery service. What this simply means is that letters, flats, and small parcels, as well as cassette tapes weighing 12 ounces or less, will be able to be mailed from APOs in our geographical location starting at 09 from us to other APOs, also with a 09 in the beginning of their zip code, at no cost. To send mail through this program at no cost, you simply need to put MPS, the letters MPS, in the top right-hand corner in lieu of stamps.
The base cafeteria is the site for our next bit of news. Not long ago, they provided dining and entertainment with pizza and square dancing night.
Heraklion Square Dancing Club meets at the Rec Center Saturday and Sunday evenings. Always welcoming new members, they've been practicing since January.
You can look for the club to perform next month on Splash Day with the official opening of the base beach. But for now, this draws to a close another chapter of Heraklion Magazine. We're glad you could be with us.
For myself, this draws to a close an entire book of Heraklion Magazines, about 2 years' worth. I'll be PCSing very soon, so this is my last episode of iMag with you. I want to say thanks for being such a great community. I've really, really enjoyed working with you. And for all the people involved with the magazine, a good friend and co-producer, Steve Hall, the man behind the scenes, the button pusher, our technical director, Bill Yock, and Deborah Hall, our spotlight editor, and everyone in the station who's helped over the last couple of years, I thank you. And as always,
thanks for watching us watch you on the picture pages of Heraklion Magazine.
Good night.